Rice discovery rewrites Pacific history. Ancient 3,500-year-old rice remains discovered in Guam shed light on early remote Oceania culture. Archaeologists have uncovered 3,500-year-old rice remains at the Ritidian Site Complex, located at the northernmost tip of Guam, marking the earliest known evidence of rice in remote Oceania. This groundbreaking discovery provides fresh insights into the ancient people who first settled the region and their cultural practices. Okay, now let's unpack the layers of this story in our deep dive on the AI podcast.
Okay, imagine this for a second. You're digging on this tropical island, Guam, miles and miles from anywhere, right?
Uh-huh.
And you find traces of rice, but get this, it's 3,500 years old.
Yeah, it's really something. And it turns out it's the earliest rice ever found in remote Oceania, way up in northern Guam.
Just incredible. And it changes things, doesn't it? How we think about, you know, how people first got there.
It absolutely does. These tiny, tiny traces, they're not even full grains.
Mm.
They tell a huge story about migration, about culture.
Right. So that's what this deep dive is all about. We're going to unpack this find. What do these microscopic bits tell us about, well, their sailing skills, farming, even their rituals?
Exactly.
Yeah.
We've been looking at the paper in Science Advances and hearing from the lead archaeologist, Dr. Michael Carson.
So we want to take you on this journey into the past. It really shines a light on human ingenuity, I think.
Definitely. Human ingenuity and cultural depth.
Okay, so let's start with the basics, the discovery itself. What did they find, where exactly, and maybe most importantly, how?
So the location is the Ritidian Site Complex. It's this archaeologically really rich area right at the northern tip of Guam. Quite remote.
It sounds like a significant spot already.
It is. And Dr. Michael Carson, he's a professor of archaeology at the University of Guam. He led this work. He's the one who detailed it all in the journal article.
Now, you mentioned they weren't full grains. That's the really interesting part, isn't it? They found something called phytoliths. Can you break that down for us? What are they?
Yeah, that's the fascinating bit about the how. Phytoliths. Okay, think of them as microscopic fossils left by plants. They're made of silica.
Silica, like glass.
Sort of, yeah. Plants absorb silica from the soil, and it forms these tiny, intricate structures inside their cells. Dr. Carson calls them fossils of ancient plant parts.
Okay.
So when the plant decays, these silica structures, they're incredibly durable. They stick around for thousands of years. And under a microscope, you can actually identify the plant they came from because the structure is unique.
Wow. So they're like tiny glass ghosts of plants.
That's a good way to put it. Yeah, it lets us see what was growing or what was used long after all the organic stuff has vanished.
Okay, so microscopic plant fossils. But the key here seems to be where they found them. You said multiple types, from husks and leaves, but only on old pottery shards, not in the soil around them, not on tools.
Exactly that, just on the earth, on their earthenware pottery fragments. Nothing on stone tools, shell tools, nothing in the general soil layers nearby.
So what does that specificity, that exclusivity immediately suggest? What does it rule out?
Well, it strongly suggests the rice wasn't just, you know, general food being processed or stored everywhere. If it were everyday cooking or storage, you'd expect to find traces elsewhere too, right? In the soil, maybe on grinding stones.
Right. It wouldn't be just on the pots.
Precisely. So finding it only on the pottery points towards a very specific relationship between the rice and those vessels. It shifts the focus immediately away from simple food towards something perhaps more symbolic or ritualistic.
Which leads us perfectly into the why. So the pottery clue is big, but the place itself, the cave where they found this stuff, it wasn't just a pantry, was it?
Not at all. This cave, it also had other things. Really fine ceramics, beautiful shell ornaments, pendants, even formal burial pits, and some rare rock art, too.
Burials and rock art. Okay, that definitely doesn't sound like a kitchen.
No. It paints a picture of a very specialized space, a cultural space, maybe ceremonial, maybe ritual, and there's more. Even the types of seashells discarded in the cave were different from the ones people typically ate back then.
Hmm. Another sign that this wasn't about daily meals.
Exactly. It reinforces this idea that the activities here were, well, special, set apart from everyday life.
And Dr. Carson, the lead archaeologist, he really leaned into this, didn't he?
He did. He said, and I'm paraphrasing slightly, that the rice likely held symbolic or ritual value, and that this cave wasn't for living or cooking day to day. It was something much more significant.
Makes sense. And others agree.
Yes. Xiaochen Hung from Australian National University supported this view. She pointed out a couple of practical things too, like Preparing rice in the cave? Probably not. You'd expect other kinds of residues, actual burnt grains maybe, which they didn't find.
Okay.
And also, storing unprocessed rice in pots in a damp cave, not ideal. It wouldn't last. The fact that it's just these phytoliths, these microscopic traces on the surface of the pottery, it really strengthens the ritual use idea. Not storage, not cooking.
So ancient rice, but used symbolically, connected to specific pottery in a special cave site. It's a completely different picture than just, you know, finding stored food.
A completely different picture.
But then, the massive question. How on earth did rice, which comes from Asia, get to Guam thousands of miles away 3,500 years ago? This sounds like an incredible journey.
Oh, it's an absolutely epic story of seafaring. This is maybe the most mind-blowing part. Dr. Carson explains that the first settlers must have brought the rice with them on their migration.
On boats, across that much open ocean.
Yes. We're talking over 2,300 kilometers. That's more than 1,400 miles of open Pacific Ocean.
Yeah.
Over 3,500 years ago.
That's staggering. For that time period, that's record-setting navigation, surely.
It really is. It pushes back our understanding of long-distance maritime migration.
Mm.
These people were pioneers, the earliest known ocean voyagers to carry a cultivated crop like rice that far from the mainland.
And they didn't just carry it, they must have successfully grown it when they arrived.
Exactly. They had to transport viable seeds or plants across that vast distance, keep them alive, and then figure out how to cultivate rice in a totally new island environment.
Mm-hmm.
It required incredible knowledge, navigation, boat building, agriculture, foresight.
Wow, it just speaks volumes about their capabilities, their planning, their, I don't know, sheer determination.
Audacity, even. It fundamentally changes how we view the scope of what early humans could achieve at sea.
It really does. And it highlights how these discoveries of ancient food, even microscopic ones like phytoliths, can give us such powerful windows into the past.
Absolutely. They connect us directly to people's lives, their skills, their beliefs. This Guam rice find, it now sits alongside other really significant food discoveries.
Like?
Well, there was that 5,000-year-old loaf of bread found recently. And researchers in the American Southwest studying ancient kitchens right on the bedrock, finding traces of food prep from millennia ago.
It's amazing what food can tell us. So this Guam discovery, it's not just about a plant. It's a human story, isn't it?
Deeply human. It's about innovation, incredible journeys, migration, but also about the sacred, the symbolic role food plays in culture. It connects archaeology, anthropology, human resilience.
All wrapped up in these tiny silica fragments, it adds such a rich layer to our understanding of the past.
And that link, you know, between food, culture, identity, it's clearly ancient.
It's
persisted for thousands and thousands of years.
It certainly seems so. Okay, so just to wrap up the key takeaways here for you listening, there are really two huge things that stand out, I think. First, that incredible seafaring achievement, carrying rice successfully over 2,300 kilometers of open water 3,500 years ago. Just phenomenal.
Truly. And second, the purpose of that rice once it arrived. Not just food for survival, but something with profound ceremonial meaning used in special ritual contexts.
Right. It challenges our assumptions, maybe, about what drove these huge undertakings in the past. It wasn't just about finding new land to farm for basic survival.
It suggests culture, ritual, symbolism. These were powerful motivators, too, powerful enough to carry across oceans.
So the final thought to leave you with is just, what does this tell us? That these early societies would put in such monumental effort, face such risks, not just for food, but for something symbolic, something sacred.
What does it suggest about how deeply intertwined food, culture, belief, and identity were even back then? And how that connection has maybe shaped human history in ways we're still only starting to grasp?
Something to ponder, definitely. That deep connection persisting across millennia.
Okay, what does the discovery of 3,500-year-old rice in Guam reveal about early human migration in Oceania? Don't forget to comment it. Thanks.